We'll start with a panel discussion on technology and O&M now. What we will try and focus on is the complete value chain, because our panel is a diverse set of members, right from module suppliers all the way to O&M players. So we'll start with the introduction, and I'll ask Mr. Rahul Khatri to start from the other end, and then we can begin the discussions.
I'm technical manager at DuPont India Private Limited. So DuPont is mainly into supply of materials for cells and modules. But besides that, we do a lot of field analysis as well, in terms of going into the field and try to analyze and inspect modules and see what kind of issues which are there in actual service conditions, and then try to share the learnings with the industry. So I guess that's one of the objectives that I'm here. And I would like to share and maybe discuss more about the stuff that we have done and how we can maybe support you guys.
Thanks, Abhay, for the opportunity. Thank you. My name is Hiten Parekh. I'm representing Everest Industries Limited, India's largest roofing company. Our goal is to provide solar compliant buildings at zero capex. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon.
I'm from Scottish Transportation. I head the business development, and I am here to talk about technology. What is the kind of push that technology really has had in India, and where are we going? What's the future? Because that's something that needs to be discussed, needs to be understood. Because when you go back, you're going to want to know how to take the next steps.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Gaurav Gupta, associate with Navitas Green Solutions for the sales and business development for the product. And here for the technology and random basis for the new product introduced in the market as per the requirement for corporate concrete products.
Hi everyone, this is Somnath Yogi from REG Solar. I am working since 10 years in the solar, and specifically for engineering and having this coding technology experience. REC basically, we are since last 20 years in this field, and I will talk about more on the technology later. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Tanya, and I'm representing Easy Solar. So what Easy Solar does is we try to make going solar extremely modular. And I'm going to be talking about how we can address the awareness gaps and the other gaps in the industry by offering a few services and products.
And my name is Abhay. I am representing Mahindra Susten. I'm a part of the operations and maintenance team, and I lead the team for performance monitoring and the field testing and data analytics. So I think to begin our round of discussions, I'll ask Tanya to start off. In a sense, you mentioned your objective is to make it easy for penetration of solar. Could you help the audience and us understand how is internet and how is e-commerce helping this happen in India today? And how is your company trying to do that? And what do you want to achieve?
So how we and this model is trying to help everybody in the industry is by bringing transparency. So we have tie-ups with various manufacturers, and they're willing to make their prices extremely transparent, which is solving one trouble in the industry of getting different prices for different volumes. So we're trying to aggregate demand and offer discounted prices. That's solving one challenge. The other challenge is that it's very difficult to get through and lies for getting subsidy and net metering services. Net metering. So again, that is being offered as a standalone service, wherein we try to bridge that gap and offer it at a price. Of course, going further, this is going to be done by the end customer, but we're again trying to make it extremely modular. And now it's going to be, going further, it's going to be extremely simple for the end customer themselves to install a rooftop solar power plant. For example, we had a client in Hisar who just purchased the entire solar power plant, well, the components that go into it from our portal. And we provide everything from panels to the last nut and bolt. So something like a solar in a box. And he just had to call a local electrician to install the entire thing. So that's the aim, wherein we try to make mainstream solar. Right now the idea is of course mainstream, but we want to make actions mainstream.
Really interesting model of how you can outsource your procurement and design, I guess. But I think what is also important while we are going into adoption of solar is understanding what are the technologies which are available today. What are the engineering tricks and tips that we can use in our projects? And I think Mr. Ritesh, with his experience, would like to share some anecdotes, some interesting trivia on how can we use
solar. PV has been more of a follower than a leader in the technology innovation space. We've basically done to a large extent just copy paste. So what have happened in Germany, what have happened in Spain, Italy, the drawings came over. Initially some of the developers hired international, then they got some drawings, and then after that it's basically just been copy paste. Best technology innovation, where are we going? What is the future? We've all been so worried about just putting the plant together, we really haven't been worried about the future. Now, once we have almost 12 gigawatts installed, now where are we going to go? Because at some point in time, we're going to hit a glass ceiling because the DISCOMs will refuse to take power in. You are going to have a terrible time getting convert the DISCOMs to you because you're just delivering power maybe 2 or 3 hours a day. So there has to be more technology innovations. There has to be much more thought process going into just into being system integrators. Now, there is, right now, it's all about price. And price is actually is detrimental. If you take a look at all the markets across the globe, specifically the European markets, the American markets, all of them have been focused more on quality with the balance. Initially, it was tremendously on quality in the German markets and all, and you've seen the way they've grown. India has had the benefit of receiving a lot of that data, a lot of that information, a lot of that technology. But we also need to start being more innovators rather than only focus on price, because now I have people who are saying they are able to install, fully installed with panels. I mean, the prices that they're quoting on seem like, I mean, I asked them, are you getting panels for free? So we're doing 250 megawatts at barely 3.3 rupees. Now, where is the economics going to work? Can you really tell me that the panel that the Chinese guy, all you've been doing is importing technology, importing and copy-pasting. Chinese guy is selling at 35 cents in the US or in Europe, whatever it is he giving the same quality at 28, 30 cents? I seriously doubt that. No matter how much we pat ourselves on the back saying that price, we also have to focus on quality. It's like saying we want the Maruti to do the safety, the performance of Maruti to do the safety and performance of Mercedes. But if you're talking price, then you have to understand that these plants are not going to last. It's just here for the short term. So that's what I'm throwing out here. Is what is it that we're going to do to get to the next level? Storage is coming, and storage has to come in. But CSP, India, we've had done a lot of innovation in the CSP, not CSP as in the solar, this thing, but in the thermal processes for the plants, for water heating, all of those, not in the electricity generation. That's what I'd like to throw out there.
Yeah, thanks.
Want me to say something more?
So I have a point to add there. Now, Chinese panels, of course, you're saying that part of it is because of the quality that they're offering such low prices. But to a large extent, I also feel it's because of the scale that they've achieved in terms of manufacturing. So if that scale is something that we can achieve in India, which is going to take a while, that's when we can expect prices to come down without compromising the quality.
I think you're getting it a little different. My point is that they're selling, I mean, we are claiming that we're getting good quality at a lower price than the others who are buying it at a higher price. It's like saying Mercedes is selling you the same version at a lower price rather than, why would it sell it to other than everybody knows what the open market prices are?
Okay, right.
I think two different points.
Just, I would love to add one point here basically, because you are talking about the price and product. If you see the other than the solar industry, normally the people, they loan the product, they declare the price, and then the user try to buy it out. And then later on you compare with the X and Y there. Solar currently, being with the even manufacturer of solar, European company, we face the issue because there are two types of products are there in the market. One is the price-based product, other is the product-based price. Now is the finally the option with the user, you want to purchase the price-based product and you want to purchase the standard product and you want to spend this certain cent extra. Because the moment the user give the target, suppose you need a module and you are giving the target was market mein to yaar 20 rupees ka mil raha hai. Yes, there are modules, 10 rupees is also available. Even 10 to, because A grade, B grade, C grade, many things are there. So now the question is, basically once the moment you say to the any particular customer who is having the flexibility to manufacture those modules, definitely he can benefit. He understands most what you need. He understands you are giving 27 cent is my target because of this 750 megawatt. Just a bit, so everybody talking about some, especially in the range of that side.
I think session is of technology and O&M.
Yeah.
None of you have spoken about that.
Sir, so point now, because this is technology, ultimately, finally, this is to start on that only with what the product is there. So we will come out on that. So regarding this fact, what I just mentioned is over here, price-based product means definitely now technology will show what the technologies are there, where the difference are there, and what are the certain parameters you have to think once you select the modules, particularly on that. That was the aspect. So,
by developers as well, India still, I would say, has a pretty small glass-to-glass installation. But let me tell you that glass-to-glass is not easy. It was, in fact, launched very long time back, around 25 years back, and there is some data available in terms of how these models perform. And what we have seen and what others have seen, there are few issues which I believe, again, which you need to understand and dial in before you invest in the glass-to-glass technology. And second thing is that there are multiple studies which have been done around glass-to-glass, and it's been shown that the glass-to-glass modules operate, or cells in glass-to-glass operate at a higher temperature, 3 to 4 degrees Celsius higher temperature compared to glass to backsheet based modules. I'm not sure again if you know about this thing, but again you can go through these reports and when you, and then you have to dial in this factor in your financial calculation to get to know the actual NPV that you will generate from your glass-to-glass installation. So I do have a lot of other things to share after, but I believe in the interest of time, I would maybe go back to Abhay, and then maybe other guys also can talk about the new technologies that what they are doing in their field.
Thanks, Rahul. So I would just like to add on to one aspect. We've spoken about modules, but also the aspect of there are newer testing equipment as well, which are being launched as we speak, which help you evaluate the performance of these modules. Whether it is electroluminescence or whether it is flash test, which is today capable of being done at the location, so at the project site, you can go and get a flash test done. There are other tools, for example, string inverters have now started coming in a big way, and there are other MPPT optimizers which are also coming into the market. While we transition from modules onto O&M side, one of the critical parts that Rahul was talking about is safety and the preparedness of the roof to be able to take on that solar PV system on top. And I think if you can throw some light on what is the latest technology or how do you make a building compatible to rooftop solar and how do you make it safe during O&M? If you can shed some light on the premise itself on which the plant is built.
Hi, good afternoon everyone. We believe very strongly that rooftop solar on the existing setup is not really the ideal thing to do because you have very limited play around it. What we are sincerely believing is that when you're designing a new building, a new house or a new factory, it's best at that time you conceive the solar rooftop at the very beginning, because then you can avoid a lot of dusting elements around that roof. You can avoid shadows, so you can place the chimneys at the right spot, so you don't waste your ideal roof space. Third is, it's very small cost to build the right walkways, the accessways and safety lines when you're constructing a new building. But on an existing building, when you've already put your polycarbonate sheets for the light to pass through, you have your turbo vents for the fan, and so many other things. One is, it makes your construction time longer, challenging, designing is challenging. Plus, it drastically reduces your ability of the roof to give you more solar power. And if you compare the cost of these things to be well planned at the beginning of the building cost, and if you see the electricity savings over 25 years when you put a solar rooftop on an industrial shed, your savings could be worth in crores for just a few lakh rupees of expense at the beginning of the building cost. From a technology point of view, we believe material selection on the solar panels is very important when you're playing with a metal roof. So we are relying on very, very high quality of back sheets. So ideally, you know, we would love to use tetra. And we did some cost benefit analysis. So if you pay maybe a 30 or a 40 pence more to a solar panel company to give you a tetra back sheet, the panel, the cost of that 40 pence per watt, it's paid off probably next 40 to 60 days of your installed time. So we strongly recommend our customers not to be penny-wise, pound foolish. Also, we feel that the use of drones is going to be very significant in the future to look at the hotspots from maybe using more and more drone technologies. Also, a lot of portable equipments to check the PV circuits or how the module is performing under the temperature effect. Also, the negative radiation which is bouncing from the ground on the back of the panel on the back sheet. I think those are really the areas which also customers need to be educated and have a very tight control on that.
So you mentioned drones, Hiten. I'd like to add a little to that. So with the platform that we've been trying to make going solar extremely modular, and once the legal side of drones becomes a little more certain, right now it's in the gray area, I think drones are going to play a very, very important role even for installers and even for end customers should they want to install solar themselves. And we're also trying to offer that as a service when it comes to, at a later point once the legal things are cleared up. So I think that's going to play an important role as well. Have you been using drones right now?
Just a 6-month-old setup, so we are really struggling to get any orders so far. But one point I missed out was also the use of robotics and ideally waterless robotics for cleaning panels, not only on the ground projects but also on the roof projects. Because if you look at it from an industry point of view, the cost of a building is typically maybe 4 to 5 crores, then the cost of a 1 megawatt solar on a roof is another 4 to 5 crores. But for industry owner, what is worth more expensive is what is lying below the panel. Below the roof is his manufacturing production equipment and machinery, and I think therefore you don't want people to be on the roof a lot of times. You want them to be there for very, very limited and short period of time. So that's also equally important to me.
So Hiten, thanks for touching on the topic of drones. It's a great introduction to this discussion. And Tanya, to answer your question, we tried out drones for thermography very recently, and the productivity is amazing. So to give you a context, a typical technician with a thermal camera can cover maybe a megawatt or two on foot. But if you use a drone, so the drone that we used was a Phantom 3 DJI, and we coupled it with an FLR Tau 2, and we covered 5 megawatts in a 20-minute flight time. So with two charges, we've covered 10 megawatts with just one single drone. So that's the kind of productivity increase that you can see. And like Hiten is rightly pointing out, in a lot of countries, this is already started and it's happening on a regular basis. So I'm sure all of us are aware of SolarCity. SolarCity has these aggregated rooftops and they have these squads which do the thermography of multiple roofs in one go, and it's all through drones. And drones are the smallest siblings of what they call the fixed wings. So there's a company in the US which is called Heliolytics. Heliolytics has an unmanned aircraft which just flies and can cover 500 megawatt in just 15 minutes. And the report is automated. So in a day, you can cover 500 megawatts at the same time, get an automated report and go exactly to the panels that are affected. So thanks for touching on that topic and sparking that conversation. Transitioning on to the O&M side and what are the key components in O&M, I would like to break down O&M into three parts. The first part is the on-ground operations and maintenance, which covers probably security, module cleaning, grass removal, etc. The second part is on the asset management side and the whole services. And the third part is remote monitoring, having a command center, and whether in India we can actually have plants which are manless. So you might have heard of Topaz, which is a 550 megawatt plant. The number of technicians there are 6 and they count in 2 or 3 shifts. If you compare that to a plant in India, let's say a 50 megawatt plant, you would have 10 technicians, 2 engineers, 1 senior engineer and maybe 12 guards. So compare the situation. So this question is to the panel and your views on whether O&M, and let's start with the on-ground manpower. Do you think the manpower can be eliminated in India and what are your thoughts on it?